This is an Alienware 51X R2 that I bought locally for $10 untested. The whole system would have cost about $700 back in the day in 2014 when this was released, but today it can be found for far cheaper, obviously, as the system hasn't aged all that well. Taking a look at the back, we can see the single slot graphics card and an i3 sticker. Spoiler alert, this system is running a GTX 745 and an i3 4130. Which I didn't know was a dual-core processor until I started benchmarking the system. We can also see the laptop-style charging port that this PC takes. I don't totally understand why they wouldn't opt for a low-profile power supply, but that's what we're working with instead. Taking a look at the front, we see two USB ports that don't work, and I'll show you why in a second, as well as an optical drive and front audio. Now, taking the system apart is fairly easy, actually. There's only about 5 screws total. The first strange thing is that the system has an upside-down vertical GPU mount, which in this system is home to the GTX 745 4GB graphics card, a single-slot OEM version that requires no additional power, even though this particular setup allows for two 6-pin PCIe power connectors to be connected to a GPU. These power connectors are rumored to be powerful enough to house a 1060 or maybe even a 1070. You can also see the system is missing a drive, so I'll put an SSD in later to test it out. Taking a look at the RAM, we can see that we're running dual channel 16GB of DDR3. Now looking at the USB ports on the motherboard, you can see that the pins are bent. I did try to bend the pins back into place, but I ended up breaking off one of the pins at the same time. So for now, the system will just have to operate without the front USBs. After taking a quick look around, I'm installing a spare SSD that I have to run a few benchmarks and tests. After installing the SSD into a not-so-secure mounting bracket, I struggled to clasp the case back together so that I could test out the machine. After reassembling the whole system, it powers on, lights up, and the fans spin. So far, so good. Taking a quick look at the BIOS, we can see that all 16GB of RAM are detected and the i3 4130 is working properly. Starting off with a CPU benchmark in Cinebench R23, the dual-core i3 is barely able to keep up, taking over 10 minutes to complete each test, getting a multi-core score of 1,909 and a single-core score of 802. We're not off to a very strong start here. Moving on to CSGO, at 1080p very low settings, which the game recommended, we get an average FPS of around 50. Keep in mind, CSGO is a very CPU-dependent game, and our dual-core i3 is trying its very best to keep up, but is still bottlenecking. Moving on to Fortnite, a game which isn't particularly well optimized other than its infamous performance mode, at 1080p medium, which is recommended by the game, we're getting an average FPS of around 40 frames per second. If we lower the settings to competitive settings, meaning view distance, epic, everything else low, we see almost no improvements whatsoever in performance. However, when dropping the resolution to 720p, we get an experience that keeps closer to 60 frames per second, but will still occasionally dip below 50 every now and then. Switching from DirectX 11 to performance mode at 1080p, we're getting a playable experience that stays around 60fps, but will also dip at times. Next up is Overwatch, a game that runs really well on low-end hardware. The game recommended a resolution of 1600 by 900 on low settings, where we get a very playable experience of 80fps average. Sometimes, even getting above 90, very briefly. The objective is now active. This will heal you. Pushing the system to 1080p at low settings, we get a near consistent experience around 70 frames per second. I will mention that during this particular test, the system did decide to crash. My best guess for this reason is either overheating or it was not getting enough power from the charging brick that I have. Moving up to 1080p medium settings, Overwatch stayed around 60fps consistently. And then moving up to high settings, we get an average FPS of around 50. So, overall, this system was a really, really great deal at only $10, even if it is a little bit old and outdated. If you made it this far into the video, I'd urge you to consider subscribing. Less than 0.1% of my viewers are subscribed, and that's a real statistic, by the way. Anyways, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want me to upgrade the system in the future, let me know in a comment below, and maybe that'll be the next video. Thanks for watching.